Hi. When I made my video on Saturday, the 4th of July, I said in that video that I would come back on midweek and talk about how I eat, what I eat, why I eat it. And this video is to explain how I've lost 14 pounds or one stone in 40 days on the Slimming World plan. Not the conventional Slimming World way, but still food optimising. And still, I believe, following the plan as a whole food, plant-based person. So, firstly, I'm going to start by telling you what I've just had for my lunch. I'm filming this on Tuesday, the 7th of July. It'll go up tomorrow. For my lunch today, I've had warm brown rice, about a couple of 100 grams cooked, with chilli beetroot diced into it, and chickpeas that I cooked this morning. And then in that, I had cumin, I had chilli flakes, I had garlic, and I topped it with a homemade slaw, which is made from raw Brussels sprouts, organic carrot, and a couple of Braeburn apples, which were cored, but the skin was left on. So what I do is I put 200 grams of sprouts, two apples, two carrots into my food processor, and I blitz it to make a slaw. And then we dress it with mustard, and this was hot mustard. So I think we used horseradish mustard, and we used some Coleman's powdered English mustard, which is free on plan. You have to sin the ready-mixed mustard. And we used some apple cider vinegar. I think that was it. Probably a bit of chilli in there, because you like things hot, don't you, Joe?
Yep.
So that was it. So it was a big bowl of food, topped with a load of slaw. And for me, those are whole foods. So when I say I'm whole food plant-based, that means whole food, as in the way it was created by God or whoever, and it means plant-based, as in not meat-based, not dairy-based, and no eggs. So that's what I had for my lunch, for anybody who's interested. Now, I'll tell you how I came to wanting to eat this way. For a while, as I shared in my video, I decided to go back to being a vegetarian. And the reasoning behind that was, as somebody who's been at Target for over 5 years, I was not finding it easy to maintain Target. In fact, being totally honest, the only way I could maintain Target was by strictly dieting, watching every mouthful of food I ate, depriving myself of the pleasures in life that I was really heavily craving, and yes, following plan, but more often than not having to white knuckle it, because if I ate anything slightly in excess of what was the right amount of food for me, it didn't seem to matter what I was eating, the weight just started to creep on. Then I got into a cycle of wanting to binge, so I could follow the plan from getting up in the morning, through breakfast, through lunch, and I'd get to 4, half 4, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and I would have killed somebody for the wrong kind of food. Because my head was in a totally wrong place. And I didn't realise back then that was because my gut was in a totally wrong place. So every day, 7 days a week, battling with trying to stay at Target. And I'm being totally honest, because I do hear other people say it's not easy to stay at Target. And I do know from the statistics that are out there, the scientific statistics that are out there, proven by doctors and weight loss organisations, that it's only somewhere between 95% and 98% of us that don't just crash and burn and go back to who or what we used to be. The number of people who have what I would call sizable weight losses. I'm not talking about somebody who's got married, gained a few pounds, come to Slimming World to get rid of those few pounds after the honeymoon period. I'm talking about people like me who've had weight problems all their lives. And the scientists do say, and the dietitians do say, that people like me who've shed a large amount of weight, and my weight loss is now in excess of 12 and a half stone, that most of us, like 95 to 98% of us, do not manage to keep it off. And to be perfectly frank with you, that scares me rigid, because I do not want to go back to the person I used to be. I don't want to go back to being fat and unhappy. So looking at maintaining a weight loss for the foreseeable future, for the rest of my life, Although Slimming World works for me as a weight loss plan, it wasn't working for me as a maintenance plan. Because when I was on the weight loss journey and I was all fired up and enthusiastic, I had a reason for doing it. When I was on the maintenance journey, I started to get bored with myself. Then I started to get fearful of certain foods. Then I convinced myself that carbs made me fat. Then I started to cut back on this and cut back on that and balance this out and don't treat yourself, don't allow yourself to have that. And it just got to be a total food obsession. And as somebody who struggled with eating disorders for the whole of my adult life, including bulimia, compulsive overeating and binge eating, then that was not a good place to be. And slowly, however hard I was trying, slowly my weight was creeping up. And it got to 10 stone 4.5, and it wasn't going to stop at 10 stone 4.5 unless I did something about it. Hence, I chose to go back to being a vegetarian because that alleviated a lot of the difficulties. But I soon learned, after about 6 weeks, it wasn't far enough because that still allowed me to eat all the things I was craving, all the things I was obsessing about. Now, some people are fortunate and can do all of those things in moderation. I'm not wired that way. I can't have a bar of chocolate in the cupboard, a packet of biscuits in the cupboard. I can't have food in the house that I'm not going to eat, because the problem with me having it in the house is, if I've bought it, something at the back of my mind intends me to eat it, and I will eat it, but I'll eat it in the wrong fashion. I'll eat it compulsively, or I'll binge on it. So I've no business having those things in the house. So I was looking for a solution. And that brought me to looking more at a plant-based diet, because I watched some people on the internet, like Crocs in the Kitchen, like Chef AJ, and there's lots, you know, there's the Physicians Committee, and there's all sorts of things out there. And I finally got around to watching more of Chef AJ. Now, she's been a vegan for 43 years, and I'm not saying I'm a vegan, I'm not. But I thought, hang on, this woman cooks, and she's been through the John McDougall program, and she goes to True North, and she mixes with all these people like Alan Goldhammer and Michael Greger and Neil Barnard and all these really learned people. I mean, they're incredible people and they're incredibly clever, and they're all proper doctors and consultants. She must have some knowledge. So I found a program, a book of hers called The Ultimate Secrets to Ultimate Weight Loss, and I started to read it on Audible. The very first thing she said was, and is this number one on my list, Joe?
Yeah.
Could go into number one? You tell me what, yeah?
Left of the red line.
Left of the red line. I thought, what does she mean? She's obviously holding something up with a red line down the middle. You can eat everything that's to the left of the red line. And then she went on to list everything that was to the left of the red line. And this was fruit, vegetables, whole grains, beans and legumes. And I thought, I love those things. That's four, you know, parts of my diet that I really love, or parts of my plan. So I listened to more of what she had to say, and she said, you know, for ultimate weight loss, don't get involved in things like avocado, too many nuts and seeds and things like that, because they're high in fat. And I thought, hang on a minute. Fruit, veg, protein from beans and legumes, whole grains, potatoes, that all fits within free food for Slimming World. I can eat all of that free on my plan. So that's what I started to do. I took what she had to offer and I put it into my Slimming World plan, because I was not looking to change my weight loss plan. I am Slimming World through and through. It's what I want to do for the rest of my life. I want to be a part of that tribe and that community. I want to have a place back on a Saturday morning where I can go to group when it's safe to go to group, feel like I belong. Okay, so taking all those foods, using them as part of Slimming World, designing every meal I ate from those four types of foods has led me to this place. Now, I'm not on here to say this is the way anyone else should work Slimming World. I'm not about that. This is not going to become a plant-based whole food diet or a whole food plant-based diet. This is not going to become a vegan channel, because I'm definitely not vegan. This is not going to become, this is the only way you can work this plan or you're a failure. It's not. And I'm never, ever going to judge anybody else for eating meat, fish, cheese, eggs, drinking cow's milk or whatever. I have my opinions on those things. but there isn't a place for those on this channel. This channel is about how iWork's living world within the boundaries of the plan and how it's working for me. And at the moment it's working. And I don't foresee a time when it wouldn't work as long as I'm eating free food. And the fact that I choose not to eat meat and eggs and fish as free food is irrelevant. It doesn't say when you join Slimming World that you have to eat everything within those sections of the plan. Lots of people come and they do this plan as vegan, they do this plan as plant-based, they do this plan as vegetarian. I mean, we've got a vegetarian lady in our group, we've got a vegan lady in our group. There are lovely people who on YouTube work this plan. I mean, Shell, Being Peace 57, she's vegan, she works this plan. Rachel from Rachel Beresford, who often comments on my channel, she's a vegetarian and she works this plan. They're not eating meat, they're not eating egg. Well, I don't know if Rachel eats eggs or not, whether she's a lacto-ovo-vegetarian. Shell doesn't. I have lovely people who comment on my channel. Janice Sexton, I think it is. She's whole food. Marsha's whole food. So lots of people are already doing this. Rebecca Shaw, if you watch Rebecca, she's lovely. She's vegetarian. So lots of people have been doing this for a long time. Jean Ella, I think she uses whole food as part of her plan, and other people do. There are other people out there doing this. I'm not alone. I'm not trying to reinvent the wheel. I'm not creating something new. I'm eating within the section of the plan that is called free foods. It feels good, and I'm loving the food, and I don't miss meat at all. So, part two, Joe.
Whole grains, not white rice, white pasta or processed foods.
Yes, so what do I mean when I talk about whole foods? Well, I'm talking about food as God created it. So next to me here, I've got a container, which is our buckwheat container. Can you show buckwheat on camera, Jeff?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, I don't think everybody will be familiar with buckwheat. I wasn't until I started eating this way. It's a grain. It's lovely. It's like little balls. It's a whole grain. You soak it overnight, like a pink liquid comes out of it. I don't know why pink. It's a bit gelatinous. But then you drain it and rinse it in the morning. You boil it for 6 minutes.
Six and a half minutes.
Drain it and you can put anything with it. It'll take up flavours.
And even though it has the word wheat in the name, it's actually gluten-free.
It's gluten-free.
It's related to rhubarb, not wheat. So.
Yeah, so if you've got a problem with gluten, don't think, can't touch that. It's got the word wheat in it. It's not, what's the other one, bulgur wheat, is that gluten free?
I don't know off the top of my head. Yeah. Probably, no, I don't think that one is.
You don't think that one is, right. This is lovely. You can even get another version of it, which is called kasha, which is toasted buckwheat. Now that you can make a kind of porridge with. So I guess if you really wanted to, you could use it in place of porridge oats and it would be free on the plant. I haven't done that, but I think I could. This other tub here, this is our rice, and we have whole grain brown rice. Now, I've never been a massive rice eater on this plan because white rice always left me hungry. I could have always eaten three bloody big portions and then I'd be hungry within the hour. But Joe got me to try brown rice, and now I'm eating brown rice, I have to say it's satiating. And the difference, if you don't know, and I didn't know, is that's the whole rice. It's got the whole husk, whatever, the outer part of the rice on it. When you buy white rice, that's been polished. It's had all the fibre polished off it. So basically what you're eating is a complex carbohydrate, yeah?
In that form, yeah.
In the form of white rice. And that's just...
No. White rice is the simple carbohydrate.
Sorry. So in the whole form, it's a complex carbohydrate. So that's good fibre, good gut fibre and filling power. In the white form, which has been polished, that's a simple carbohydrate. And it's very much like it'll just burn like sugar.
And just basically digest too quick.
So, yeah, because there's nothing really there for your body to have to work on.
You've taken all the fibre out, so it just digests too quick and then your blood sugar goes up and then you just like start that kind of roller coaster of being like over and under the amount of blood sugar and yeah.
That's why white rice always made me hungry. Now I'd say the same thing for what we think of as pasta. Not wholemeal pasta. Wholemeal pasta's got the outer part of the wheat in it, and it's got filling power and it's got more fibre. I don't tend to touch pasta. It's never been my like go-to grain or go-to carb, but whole grain pasta I would eat if I fancied it. White pasta, which is what we call ordinary pasta, it's the same as white rice. It's a simple carbohydrate. Your body will burn it too fast. And I think, looking back, you know, over the years, I used to have a plate the size of a dustbin lid full of food, because pasta never filled me. I could always eat more. I could eat that, and then I'd go back for more. My husband would tell you, he's like, my God, how do you manage to eat that much pasta? Because it just made me hungry, because it was spiking my blood sugar, and then a while later my blood sugar would drop and then I'd need more, and it had no filling power.
Yeah, because the problem is your body notices that your blood sugar is getting a bit too high, and then it releases insulin to lower it and store the excess sugar and get you back down to normal. But because it's gone so high, it kind of overshoots with the insulin, and then you end up under.
And then you're hungry
And then you're hungry again. You're hungry again, so you start craving carbs.
Yeah. So if you're in a position like I was, where white pasta, ordinary pasta, just doesn't do it for you, doesn't satisfy you, that's why. So we're now about whole grains, whether it's buckwheat, whether it's rice, whether it's whole grain pasta, whatever, we're about whole grains. We don't eat processed grains anymore, which has been a real eye-opener for me, because I just didn't realise things like brown rice, that was so nice. I mean, you can get a whole wheat couscous if couscous is your thing, but then couscous is just another pasta. But if you're going to buy it, probably try the whole grain. Okay?
Yeah, or there may even be other whole grains that are similar, like millet.
Yeah, millet is a good one, or, that Shell recommended. Amaranth we've got.
Yeah, we've got.
As I say, cashew.
Yeah,
that's a whole grain, toasted buckwheat.
But you may, like, I thought they were all going to be like quite similar, but they're not, are they?
No, they're very different.
I thought buckwheat would be like rice, would be like amaranth, but they're not. They're all really
different. They're all really different, and there's loads more to explore. I mean, we're only just like putting our toe in the water. We're only at the start of this journey. We're only like 43 days in. We've got years of this to come, and loads of food. There are thousands of grains and beans and vegetables to make your meals up from. It's not a limited way of eating at all, is it, Joe?
No. In fact, there's more variety in my diet now, I think, than there ever was before.
Says the guy who had 19 fruit and veg the other day, because he's better at that part of it than I am. But yeah, brown rice. Who ever thought that I would just like, yeah, brown rice, I just love it. But it's not at all what I expected. I used to think, oh God, hippie food. It just didn't appeal to me. It really didn't. But now it does. And buckwheat is my favourite at the moment. And things like amaranth and that, you can make, again, a porridge from that. Shell tells me that millet is really nice. So that's going to be the next one I try. Next section.
Okay. Three. Potatoes have as much protein as you need. Excess protein is converted to carbohydrates.
Now, this is an interesting one, because when I've said to like family members and friends about going whole food plant-based, they've asked me two questions, and the first one has been, where on earth are you going to get your protein from? So I had to I need to focus on where am I going to get my protein from? And I was listening to Dr. John McDougall from the Starch Solution and Dr. T. Colin Campbell from the China Study. And both of them said the same thing at different points in their books. They said, you can get as much protein as you need in your daily diet from the whole potato. The problem is that in the 21st century in the Western world, we think we need a lot more protein than we actually need. And our bodies don't expect to have that much protein. You know, so you look at a protein bar and you can say, I don't know, 12 grams of protein in this bar. Or you might look at a vegan meal or plant-based meal in the freezer at the supermarket and it'll say however many grams of protein in this. Or you might look at making yourself a spaghetti bolognese and work out how much protein is in your mince or whatever, your chicken, your cheese, your eggs, whatever. And you start adding up your protein. And people get to silly numbers. Where actually, from what I understand, and Joe would correct me, I think, if I was wrong, you only need about 50 grams for a woman and 60 grams for a man, max. We can be healthy on a lot less than that. And excess protein is a dangerous thing. And I don't say that lightly. I'm in the middle of reading the China study by T. Colin Campbell, Dr. T. Colin Campbell. And I'm reading a section about cancer, and he's telling me what excess protein does to growing cancers and things. And I'm thinking, gee, mini cricket. I'm not sure I really needed to know this. But the thing that I have taken from it that is really valuable to me is the fact that I don't have to have massive amounts of protein in my diet. That I can get protein from things like potatoes, vegetables, beans and legumes, rice.
All plants contain protein in some high quantity.
Yeah, all plants contain protein. So if you've got broccoli on your plate, if you've got spinach on your plate, if you've got sweet potatoes, ordinary potatoes, if you've got cauliflower, they've all got a measure of protein in them. And that was a bit of a revelation to me, shall we say, because I've always thought of eggs. Like, what's your best source of protein? Eggs and prawns. But I think I got that a bit mixed up with cholesterol. I don't need to eat a chicken leg. I don't need to eat a chicken breast. I don't need to eat lamb's liver. I don't need to eat veal. I don't need to eat venison. I've eaten all these things in my time, but I don't need to. So it's choice, isn't it? Choice power. I'm not saying anybody else shouldn't. I have no problem with what anybody else chooses to eat. I'll go out for a meal with anybody who's having a big steak or whatever. I'm not going to sit there and say, no, you shouldn't be eating that. That's not my business. But what I am saying is, if you come to my house, you'll get whole food plant-based meals. Richard's enjoying them at the moment.
Yeah, you'd be getting beans or tofu, won't you?
Beans or tofu or tempeh.
Yeah.
Yeah. And lots of it. Because this is not a way of eating where you have to limit what you eat. Because most of the food is low calorie density, you can actually eat a lot of food on this plan. So you don't need to weigh anything apart from your healthy extras. You don't need to sin anything apart from icing seeds and excess milk or stuff like that.
That's another point as well, though, because in the bit where you were talking about, like, unprocessed foods, like, we're trying to avoid oils as well, aren't we?
Oh, God, yeah. 1 pound of spinach or greens has 100 calories. 1 pound of olive oil has 4,100 calories. Do you know, I used to get really good expensive olive oil from Collegios, and I used to pour it in a dish, and then I'd have a dish of balsamic vinegar, and then I'd have gorgeous focaccia bread, and I would just sit there and soak my bread in the olive oil until that bowl was empty, and then I'd refill the bowl and do it again. I didn't know there was 4,100 calories in a pound of olive oil. Now, there's nothing wrong with eating olives, that's a whole food.
Yeah, but there's nothing wrong with eating nuts and seeds.
No, but they're the things on the Simply More plan that I would have to weigh and either sin or use as a healthy extra. That's why it fits within this plan. Because there's nothing that I would contemplate eating on the whole food plant-based diet that doesn't fit perfectly, absolutely perfectly within the Slimming World plan for me. So, yeah, that's... Any other point we need to make on that about protein?
Any excess protein is just basically, like, turned into...
Oh, yeah, carbs. Can you read that bit that you read to me once?
Okay, so... when protein is burned for fuel, about half of the energy goes to a process named gluconeogenesis to produce glucose. Our bodies have little ability to store protein. We can only do it by slowly burning new lean mass. So dietary protein in excess of needs is burned as fuel, with roughly half ending up as glucose.
Now, if you think of the cost of food that is high protein, you know, your steak and chicken, whatever.
It's like the most expensive bit of your meal.
It's the most expensive part of your meal. And yet it ends up as glucose, which is what rice ends up as.
Well, any excess.
Any excess. Well, you're not, you know, it's very easy to overeat on protein. Somebody says to me, I mean, I've seen this in group. I'm not saying it's shame on anybody, but I've seen people in groups say, oh, you can buy a whole rotisserie chicken and just eat that. Yeah, you can, but why would you?
It's just expensive carbohydrates at that point, isn't it?
Yeah. If the excess from that is going to end up as glucose, you'd have been better having a quarter of the chicken with a jacket potato. You'd save some money. because it is a flipping expensive way to produce glucose in your body. I mean, a jacket potato will end up as glucose, won't it? Rice will end up as glucose. Carbs end up as glucose. But if you think of the amount of money we can spend on a, you know, a steak or chicken or fish, salmon, it's an expensive way to make glucose from your excess. And you really, 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 I would encourage anybody, if you're seeing dieting information that's pushing protein, and a lot of the diets do, different forms of diets, you may believe in it. I mean, argue with me if you believe in it. I really don't mind. But if you're seeing diets that are mainly pushing proteins, it's generally coming from either a meat background or a dairy background. And there's nothing wrong with either of those businesses. I've got good friends who make their money from both, you know, make their income from both of those businesses. I'm not knocking them. But what I'm saying is, just look for any hidden agenda. If somebody tells you you need to get your calcium from milk, then it's usually the milk marketing board. And if somebody tells you you need to be eating this because this is where you'll get your protein and you need a massive amount of protein, I'll bet you a pound to a dollar that that's a meat company telling you that.
Do you remember what we read marketing the other day where it was saying in the short term, protein may be like the most filling macronutrient, but over like four or five hours, it actually ended up being fiber. Like protein is the most filling in the short term, yeah, but fiber is the most satiating in the long term. Yeah, so
protein will fill you while you're eating your meal, and you'll get to that satiation point quicker.
So by the time you get to your tea, you're not as hungry for your tea.
Yeah, because they'll say, take 20 minutes after you've eaten, then you'll feel your fullest. You get that from protein quicker. But in the long term, 4 hours later, when it gets to tea time, you're less hungry for your tea if you've eaten more fibre. Because fibre, digesting slowly, keeps you full. And then, do you know what? There ain't one calorie in fibre. Fibre's calorie free, it's just bulk. So you might eat a jacket potato, and there are calories in a jacket potato, but the fibre part of it that goes through and out the other end has got no calories in it at all. Is there another point, Joe?
I'm just trying to think of anything you've said over the past couple of days.
What number was that?
Sorry, that was number 3.
No, you need to speed up a bit. I think I went out of time otherwise. Number 4?
Gut bacteria and how to change it.
Yeah.
Fibre isn't just bulk.
But it helps towards filling you up with bulk, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But that's what that whole book's about, not just being bulk.
That's what I'm going to say. This book, Fibre Fueled, by Will, and I can't say his surname, Bolschwitz, is about how to change your gut bacteria with your food. So the fibre that we eat is filling, and it has a place, and it's bulk. But it's also the food for your microbiome.
Yeah.
So if you want a good gut microbiota, you must feed the microbiome. And if you are just eating sugary rubbish and junk food all day long, you're feeding a proportion of your microbiome with sugar and rubbish and junk, and you're keeping that microbiome going, so it sends a message to your brain, I want more. I want more sugar, I want more cake, I want more junk food. If you can selectively feed the other gut bacteria that wants healthy food, that wants vegetables, that wants whole foods and whatever, they will actually become the greater proportion of the gut microbiome, and you will lose that craving for sweet things and junk. No high fat, high salt, high sugar. It changes your taste. And your gut microbiome is what dictates the state of your health. If you're feeding a healthy gut bacteria, you're making healthy skin, you're making healthy hair, you're making things that matter. I mean, you can literally change your body. You can turn your life around from being type 2 diabetic by changing your gut bacteria and eating the right foods. It all sounds really extreme, and I think if you're interested, we'll give a list of books at the end that I've already read that have really helped me. But yeah, this book is amazing. The only bit of it I didn't like was the recipe section in the back, because being American, it was 1,001 ingredients every week. I found it a bit, I said to Joe, this doesn't translate well to the English for me because half the stuff on the shopping list we wouldn't be able to get. Can I have 0.5, Joe?
Whole food, plant-based, not vegan or vegan junkie.
Yeah, I just want to touch on why this applies to me, why I wouldn't call myself a vegan. Coming to this place on the swimming world, I want to eat healthily, I want to get my cholesterol down and all that sort of thing. What I don't want is to just switch from eating, shall we say, everyday junk foods to eating vegan junk foods. The world is very different for vegans today than it was, say, 10, 20 years ago. We didn't have so much vegan chocolate, vegan cakes, vegan biscuits, vegan ice cream, vegan everything. Vegan bread, because not all bread is vegan. Vegan spreads, vegan cheeses, vegan yogurts. We didn't have so much of that years and years ago. Nowadays, I think I could eat just as badly and just as obsessively and compulsively on a vegan diet as I do on what I call the everyday way of eating, the ordinary way of eating for this country. Because if I'm compulsive and what I want is chocolate and I'm prepared to like knock the walls down to get into Asda to get chocolate, I can even buy Galaxy vegan chocolate. I don't need to go to the extreme, really strong stuff and that. And for me, that's a dangerous place. You know, you can get vegan Magnums. Well, I wouldn't eat one, I'd eat the box. You can get sugar-free Magnums, which maybe they're not vegan, maybe they are. But I can never eat one, I eat the whole box. So I don't want to put myself in a place as a vegan where I could just carry on doing what I've always done. So I think there's a vast difference between vegans who eat for health and vegans like me who would just eat junk food vegan stuff. You know, the sweeties and the ice cream and the cake and the biscuits. So I don't want to label my channel vegan out of respect for people who do vegan plan for ethical reasons and that, because that's certainly not me. I just want my plan to be about healthy eating and what I really enjoy. I'm going to cut off at this point and I'm going to do a part two because this video is now like half an hour long. So we will be back, and if you look in the titles for the videos, it will come up as part two. So see you on the other side.